Very good morning, students. We are on the viva on the vertebrae. So this short video is for the cervical vertebrae. That means I will give you some of the important questions which are asked by the examiner while they are taking viva on the cervical vertebrae. Now the vertebrae on your examination table will be lying like this mix. And he may ask you the question if he is in mood to ask about the cervical vertebrae. He may ask you how you will identify a cervical vertebrae. Now, the most important clue to identify the cervical vertebrae is the presence of foramina transversarium in the transverse process. That means there is a presence of a foramina in a transverse process. For example, this is a typical cervical vertebrae. Okay, so this is the transverse process on either side of the body, and this is that foramina transversaria in the transverse process. This is anterior tubercle and posterior tubercle. The whole thing is the transverse process coming out from the lateral surface of the body by the side of the pedicle and that of the articular process here. So this area is that of the transverse process, and you can say him that all the cervical vertebrae, they are identified on the basis of presence of foramina transversaria onto the transverse process. So this is cervical vertebrae. This is also showing the presence of the foramina transversarium here. So this is also cervical. This is also the cervical because, so all cervical vertebrae will show the presence of foramina transversarium. The rest of the other vertebrae, they are not the cervical because they are not showing the foramina transversarium. Okay, so that is the correct answer and how you should identify a cervical vertebrae. Okay, then he may ask you which are the typical and which are the atypical cervical vertebrae in the vertebral column. Okay, in the cervical vertebral column, you can say that the cervical first, cervical second, and cervical seventh are atypical cervical vertebrae. The remaining, that is from third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, they are the typical because their morphological or anatomical bony features, they resemble to one another. That's why the 3 to 6 cervical vertebrae, they are the typical vertebrae. Typical vertebrae. Now then he asks you what are the parts of the cervical vertebrae. Like any other vertebrae, you can tell that there is a body and then there is a neural arch. The neural arch means pedicle and lamina on one side, pedicle and this lamina, thin flat vertical plate of the bone, it is the lamina. This forms the neural arch. That means pedicle on right and left side, lamina on the right and left side, which fuses in midline to form a spinous process. They enclose a vertebral foramina. These structures, they are the neural arch or the vertebral arch structure. Okay. Now, then he may ask you immediately, because you will get an idea, to ask about the vertebral foramina. He may ask you why the size of the vertebral foramina in cervical vertebrae, if you will see all cervical vertebrae, it's quite large, okay, and it is triangular in shape. Okay, so the vertebral foramina is triangular and large. Large as compared to the size of the body or the size of the vertebra itself. Because if you compare the cervical vertebra here with that of the lumbar vertebra here, you will see that the foramina is much more large as compared to that of its size. But here you can see that vertebral foramina is smaller as compared to the size of the vertebrae. Okay, as compared to the size of the vertebrae. So what you will say that the triangular foramina, large foramina, Here it is because of the fact that the pedicles are directed backwards and laterally. See these pedicles? And these pedicles are directed too much laterally, backwards and laterally. And because of the divergence of the pedicles which are going laterally, the foramina is large and triangular in shape. Suppose these pedicles were directing directly backwards, then the foramina would have been very small. Then you will say that, okay, is it for the passage of the cervical enlargement of the spinal cord? That's why the vertebral foramina in the cervical vertebrae is large. You may say that this is one possibility, that since the cervical enlargement of the spinal cord is passing through the cervical vertebral column, that's why there is a large triangular foramina. But the other view is that since the vertebrae are very small and they are just have to support the head and neck region, I mean the head and brain, which is almost 5 to 6 kilogram in the weight, they have, this column has to support, and support has to be based on the wider area. So it is based on wider area because the two articular facets and body which forms the intervertebral joints are supporting this weight in the very small vertebrae. And second fact is that the vertebral column is highly mobile, various movements are possible, and this is the reason why it has to be a large foramina to protect the cervical enlargement of the spinal cord and to provide a wide base on which the load has to be transmitted. Okay, now then he may ask about the superior articular facet. The direction of the superior articular facet, which you see in a typical cervical vertebra, you will see that it is sloping. Okay, from superior to inferior side, you will see that this slope is seen, which is very well appreciated when you see it from its lateral side. So this inclination is there, okay, slope, and that's why this articular facet in one direction they are facing posteriorly, okay, but at the same time most of the superior articular facet they are also facing posterolaterally, because the movement between the two cervical vertebrae, then of the rotation, flexion, okay, and that of the side bending is possible because of this orientation of articular facet. Now you can say that this articular facet, as it is seen here in C7 vertebrae, they are also sloping here, okay, vertically, as well as they are directed slightly to posterolaterally. So this facet, they give a, I mean to say, they are responsible for the wide range of the movement. But then you can say that this is not the direction of articular facet in all the typical cervical vertebrae, including C7. That means the C3 cervical vertebrae facets are just opposite. They are always directed backwards and medially. If you see the direction of the facet, I am not having any third cervical vertebrae, C3. Otherwise, I would have shown you that C3 facets are directed posteromedially, not posterolaterally, or not that sloping as it is in case of a fourth, fifth, sixth, or seventh cervical vertebrae. Now, why this facet of C3? He will ask you, they are directed posteromedially. You can say that this articulation, its articulation with the inferior facet of cervical 2 vertebrae on C3 will prevent the rotatory movement. That means the C2 is fixed, okay, it cannot move like the other vertebrae in cervical region are moving because of this orientation of C3 posteromedial facet. And this is necessary because it provides the stability, okay, to the C2 vertebra, so that C2 remain fixed when the rotatory movements or side to side movements are taking place at atlantoaxial joint. That means between the first and second cervical vertebrae, side to side movements efficiently can take place only when C2 is stable. And this stability is provided by that of the C3 cervical vertebrae, okay? C3 facets, orientation of the C3 cervical vertebrae. Now, then he may ask you why there is a presence of an articular pillar. See this, if you see it from lateral side, articular pillar is there between superior and inferior articular process. Okay, you can say that it is for the load transmission because of the concavity posteriorly, the curvature, cervical vertebral curvature is posterior concave, hence the load is going through this vertebral pillars, articular pillars, which is formed between from the lower end of the C2 to the C7 vertebrae, which is just passing a lot of the load. And then he may ask why the lamina of the C2 is very thick. You can see here how thick is the lamina of the C2 as compared to the lamina of a typical cervical vertebrae, which is paper thin, okay, very thin, very thin. Again, the same region you can give that the load is distributed, load of the head is distributed onto the two superior articular surface, okay, and then it goes to the pedicle before it goes to the inferior, two inferior and body. So it is diffused onto the lamina. It is, so the lamina is a weight bearing structure in the C2, while because of the presence of the articular pillar between C3 to C7, the load is not diffused onto the lamina, it is not going through the lamina, it is going on to the column itself, okay. That's why the laminae of the C3 to C6, they are thin. Again, it gets diffused on C7, okay. Again, it gets diffused. Then if you are replying very well, okay, like this, then there may be a question that how you will identify a typical cervical vertebra, okay. Suppose if he says that this is an atypical cervical vertebra, then you can say, sir, no, this is not an atypical, this is typical cervical vertebra, because an atypical cervical vertebra is C1, and if we see to the C1, there is no body, and there it is a shape is the ring sap, so it cannot be C1, it is a typical, so C1 is a ring shape, so you can just eliminate that, this is not C1, this is not. Then you can say that for C2, there is an odontoid process, okay, which represent the body of the C1, which is there, tooth-like projection. And since this tooth-like projection is here, this is C2 atypical, so it is not C2 also, neither it is C1, neither this typical is C2, okay. And then when we compare a typical C7, then you can see that there is a long process of C1, which is not bifid. See here, this is the bifid tubercle is there in the process, but here it is not. So this cannot be C7. Thus, it is C1, this is C2 and C7. In this way, you can identify the atypical, okay, and the rest of the vertebrae from C3 to C6 will be typical vertebrae, okay. So this may be the question which can be asked on the cervical vertebrae, okay. I hope that you will be able to answer between and differentiate between typical and atypical cervical vertebrae. Thank you very much for watching this video.